Ability for the society. Kalau you tengok gambar ni, capitalism, ayat tu tak nampak, tak clear kan? Tapi ini capitalism, the people who are, is actually the system itself. Yeah? The system of capitalism is where people who owns money is able to control, yeah, this lower, the second tier. We have the king here, we have the ministers, we have the judges, judges kat bawah. We have the people of executive lah, yeah. They are in power and they are actually having this priest, yeah. They are the priest ini, ada judge ini, yeah, and pope and things like that. So these ministers or the one that is controlling the society behavior, kalau kita tengok, is the one that is controlling the what they call it, the system. Ataupun the agencies, yeah, agencies that is guiding in terms of the police, army and things like that. And then we have the executive, you know, we have those people who are so-called leaders of companies, you know, general managers and so on. And then the workers down there, nampak tak? The actual apa, the one that is holding the whole structure is actually the workers, you know. And you can see a picture of a boy died here and things like that. Condition are bad down there. So actually these are the workers, and they, all these people up there, are actually benefiting. They don't produce anything, but they just consume. And they utilize the law in order for the law to benefit themselves. And why they are benefiting, because the structure is there. You have to maintain the structure, otherwise the society will collapse. So this is what capitalism from the perspective of Karl Marx says. Kalau kita nak letak, kita boleh letak apa, Illuminati, yeah. We can say that Illuminati are those people who are actually in control of the whole. It's not about the government, it's not about the monarch, it's not about the state, it is about somebody that is higher, that is holding the money. You know, people who hold the money, actually kalau kita tengok company-company yang multinational company throughout the world, their income is more than the income of a country. You know, they are so powerful to the extent that they can influence who is going to be the prime minister or president of a country. In America, that is very, very clear. Whenever there is a presidential election, people of multinational companies, they will inject money, yeah, to those apa, candidates that is able to support them. So these presidents, once they are in power, they will formulate certain policies or certain laws to be able to benefit the people who are the, as I already mentioned, the multinational companies. So it is not about the company, the owner of the company, which is the state, the shareholders. The shareholders are the one that is actually controlling the whole world. So you can see that from the perspective of distribution of wealth, worldwide. Kalau kita tengok distribution of wealth, apa, disparity, kita akan nampak the number of people holding wealth, global inequality. Kalau kita tengok, ni boleh kot, boleh nampak. Okay, you will see some reports in with respect to apa, distribution of wealth. Kalau kita tengok distribution of wealth of people, there would be, I would say, katalah 100 people that is controlling about 70% of the rich, the wealth of the world. So why they are in that position? They are wealthy because the system that we apply. So Marx says that the system is faulty. System is not benefiting those who is at the bottom. So this has to change, you know. So when there is a consciousness of the society about the the effect, negative effect of capitalism. So they are more towards socialist, yeah, in terms of the society. So mainly kebanyakannya European countries nowadays, they are socialist in nature. Socialist whereby they concentrate on the society more as compared. Yeah. It is the duty of the state in order to take care of the society. So kadang-kadang kita tengok the highest cuti workers in the world, it so happen rasanya one of them is dekat France, eh, when they under mandatory of the law for them the workers to be to get more day off. Okay, you can actually get you can break away from your work in order for you to go to holiday, yeah, for several months. So what this slide is trying to say is that people are fed up and then people are moving towards socialism, and obviously under Marxism or communism, it is even worse, yeah, in terms of what will happen to all these people yang kat atas ni. Whenever the structure is being thrown down, there would be one standard level, which is what we call under communism, commune, meaning everyone is able to share everything together. Okay, so these people are very worried, so they don't want that to happen. They have to restructure and think about the rule of the law. So you have to give them, these people yang kat bawah ni, some sense of belonging, some sense of the ability for them to control their life. So they are not victims, they are not merely slave, yeah. So the new terminology of slave, yeah, in terms of company workers. So that is the development in terms of industrial relation. So it was worse, it improved later because the fear of people who are in power in capitalism, and to be able to not to lose their power, so they have to come back to give all the benefits, yeah, of rights to the workers. So that is where justice, equality and fairness is the one that is being in the eyes or in the hearts of everyone. Okay, the employer were worried that they might lose their factory, because if you have revolution, some of them will be killed, their company is going to take over by the state, and they cannot make as much money as they did earlier on. So the society, obviously, they want justice, fairness and equality in a way that they want to topple these people down and be the owners of the company themselves, but by giving them some share of the benefit of workers, then it will pacify dia punya kemarahan yang dia orang ada terhadap syarikat. So that is the development of the understanding of why industrial relation sampai sekarang. We have the law in order for the law to protect the what they call it, employees, yeah, and actually the law is not only meant to protect employees tapi to protect the employer themselves juga, and this is rights and duties for the employees, right, and duties for the employer. So we are learning that in order for us to know how the law can come in, right, how the law can come in, we have to look at the relationship first. You must be able to establish the relationship, otherwise the law would not be able to come in. So that is the situation bila kita tengok dekat this particular diagram. Industrial relation is actually bigger than employee relationship. Yeah? Employee relationship, whenever an employee and employer signs in their contract of employment, therefore it will involve the industrial relation, because it is not only for the employee and employer sahaja, it is something that is bigger. Why? Because it involves so many other people, yeah. Tapi for the time being, what we are going to look at what we are going to look at is the provision of the law, yeah. You remember So the law was created to be able to achieve some sort of happiness to the society, meaning the people who are workers. So it has to be something that everyone respect. So it must come from the the parliament. So in Malaysia, we have Employment Act to protect the relationship of employee who are lower in their income. And then we have the workmen. Workmen would be those people who are also workers of the company, but they are not, the minimum, they have a salary of more than 2,000 ringgit. So if you are having an income of more than 2,000 ringgit, therefore you are considered as workmen. So there is a special law that is going to be utilized by you, which is called Industrial Relations Act. Now, the law will only, the act as a shield and a sword, remember? Because you are the rights, kan? Rights and duties, so everyone can utilize the law in order for them to get justice, fairness and equality. So it will only be there, these two acts, Industrial Relations Act and Employment Act, can only come in when there is a relationship. Kalau tak ada relationship, legal relationship, there is no, apa orang kata, there is no avenue ataupun locus standi for the law to come in. Okay, so contractor is someone that is outside the scope of the law, which is the industrial relationship near law. Contractor is merely is within the area that you have learned under Contract Act, okay, 1950. So if they were to be contractors of the company, obviously it will fall under rights and duties under the provision of Contract Act. So that is the scenario. Kita nak kena tengok ni sebab kita nak tengok the role of industrial relation dengan Employment Act and how can they come in. That is the relationship that you have to establish. Now, when you talk about industrial relationship, it is about you, your relationship with you, your relationship with the employer. This is you and the employer, kan? Kita nampak yang atas ni, yang kecil ni, workman and employee. But it is actually larger than that because you are having interrelationship between the government, irrespective whether you like it or not, because that relationship is called what we call industrial relation law. Okay. Whatever you are complaining about the employer, obviously you can complain to labor office. Yeah? You can go there and complain. If you are the representative of trade union, obviously it will involve government agencies, yeah? In order for the government to be regulating the relationship. Yeah? Because employer ni, as I said last week, dia tak boleh dibiarkan, eh? Because it will be like the one yang kita tengok tadi, industrial relation of this nature, eh? Di mana dia orang akan abuse their position. Yeah, it will be something that the government is very serious to control. And then we have the courts. You know, government is administrative, the court is justice. So obviously the court can come in to play their role into giving you your justice. And then we have the trade union, your big brother, that should be able to take care of you, because when you fight with the employer, obviously the employer have deep pockets. They can go and take you to court and then employ solicitors, lawyers that is very intelligent and knowledgeable, because they have money. So you cannot afford to get lawyers. Why? Because you don't have money. Okay. So you need trade union in order for you to fight your case. Yeah. If you want to, because you need to survive. You need to work. Yeah. That is the environment, the system that we apply. Nobody is able to not to work. Okay. Everyone have to work. So in order for you to work, you want to be in a position that you feel safe, while working and not being abused by the employer. So the trade union will come in to save you whenever that you think you need to be safe. Then you have the relationship between you and other employees. See, in a work environment, it's not about you and the employer. It is about you and your fellow employees. So say, for example, abuse or things that might happen between you and your fellow employees would be able to give you some grounds for you to make complaint to the government, make complaint to the court, in terms of sexual harassment, let's say, for example. So it is where this dynamic relationship is not only merely existing because of you and the employer, but that because of your relationship of you and the employer, it will involve other people. So we are going to look at the running ataupun the application of the Trade Union Act, then the Industrial Relations Act with the Employment Act. Okay, so there's Trade Union Act that is controlling the trade union, and the Industrial Relations for those people that is more than 2,000, and Employment Act for less than 2,000. So all these actually mechanism, the law is, I would see it as this lah. It is some component that is must be functioning with one another in order for it to have a good outcome. So it's a, whenever you have a good machine, obviously the outcome is good, right? Kalau you have a good car, that there is no problem with the engine, obviously the performance of the car is very reliable. So that is what we want. So we are going to look at mostly two of the area, which is Employment Amendment Act and the Employment Act. So this one, the amendment, it must be done every now and then. If you can see the Employment Act and compared to the amendment that was made, this one is 2012. I think in the process, I don't know whether they have done revision to the Employment Amendment Act, which hopefully able to give more benefit to our protection to the employees nowadays. But what I'm trying to say here is that the law has to be able to upgrade itself, to be able to be effective. So progress of law has to be changed. So as I already mentioned, your relationship with the employer also involves trade union, employees and the government. Okay, now let's look at definition then. What do you mean by employee? Okay, here employee is a person or class of person include in a category in the first schedule of the extent of specified therein in the first schedule, and the one that is from the minister who make an order under subsection 3 of 2A. So let's look at the first schedule. Okay, you look at the first schedule down there, first schedule. This is considered as who is employees. Yeah? So any person, any yang lama, 2,000 ringgit. Eh? So any person who is entering his contract of service, here is important for us to understand contract of service, and wages that is less than 2,000 ringgit. So this particular law will come in order, the Employment Act will come in order for them to protect the employee. And then any person who wages above then, where he is actually whatever amount, we are not talking about 2,000 ringgit. He can be workers that is earning, nama dia foreman, pekerja, tapi digaji dia 4,000, you know, because the nature of work that they are doing. So here, if he engage in the manual labor, including labor such an artisan or apprenticeship, so that is considered as a person also covered under this law. If he is engaged in operation and maintenance of mechanically operated vehicles, then is also under this particular definition. He is a supervisor, and apa supervisor of other employees also he is going to be protected by this law. And then if he is engaged in a capacity of vessel, yeah, in registered in Malaysia, so you tengok kapal-kapal apa semua tu, then they are also protected under the Employment Act. And last, engaged in a domestic servant. So kalau kita tengok the domestic servant, we have a situation whereby this servant actually are protected under the same act. But sadly, it does not happen. Domestic servant banyakannya tak dipedulikan, you know. They don't have their working hours. They, the time that they are supposed to work is unlimited, you know. Pukul 2 pagi pun boleh dipanggil untuk nak buat sesuatu and things like that. They don't have their weekdays, weekends, yearly, you know, pay, overtime pay, you know. It is not something that is happening as what it should be. So, coming back, so that is what the definition of employee. If that particular person falls under this category, then they are having every rights to be protected under Employment Act or any amendment to the Employment Act if there is any. Okay, so in total, they are protected by the law. Okay. Questions so far? Okay. Coming back to employee. Yeah. So if you are looking at employee in terms of Employment Act, this is the definition. But if it's not, then if you are earning more than 2,000 ringgit, then obviously the here we are looking at employees who wages do not exceed 5,000. I'm sorry, we are still in the employee lagi, yeah. Whereby if you say, for example, you are a person that is earning less than 5,000, then you can utilize this law or the provision of Employment Act in order for you to take your case against the employer by going to the Director General of Labor. So kalau you tak puas hati dengan your apa kata employer, obviously you can utilize this provision of Section 69 Employment Act to state your case against your employer, yeah, and to take to ask the Director General to take up your case. For example, here unpaid wages. If you have an employer yang jenis tak ikut the provision of the law, kita the first week ataupun the 7 days after the month ends, the period of the what they call it, the period of employment, you are supposed to get your salary. So ini bertepatan dengan statement of Rasulullah dalam hadis ini mengatakan, sekiranya bekerja, berilah upah kepada pekerja tersebut sebelum dia punya peluh kering, you know. So 7 days, I think that is reasonable, that is reflected from the provision of the law. Okay, if it's more than that, then complaints can be made and the Director General can make it a case against the employer for not paying on time. And then other things that you can complain would be other payments that is in cash due under the agreement under this clause. For example, employment agreement. Say, for example, you are supposed to get your monthly allowances, you know, and that monthly allowances, you are not getting it. So you can, if your salary is less than 5,000, you can complain to the Director General of Labor in order for the Director General, meaning not the Director General per se, is the staff, get Labor Office to come into the picture and try to save the day. Yeah, so that is employee. Now, workman, as I already mentioned earlier on, workman is bigger scope, yeah, the green scope yang I kata tadi tu. Okay, this is workman, they are protected under the Industrial Relation Act. Okay, so any person who is employed to working include apprentice employed by employer under contract of employment. Okay, again, contract of employment, work or for hire or reward. Okay, kadang-kadang they will engage in a certain period of time. Mungkin ada certain reward that you will get in order for you to do your contract. For the purpose of proceeding in relation to trade dispute, includes any person who has been dismissed. So if you are being dismissed, which is your salary is above 2,000, but you are being dismissed, therefore you can see yourself as workman, and you are able to utilize Industrial Relation Act to sue against the employer. Recently, my wife and other student telling us about dia baru kerja tapi dia sebagai temporary on probation. So they terminated him 24 hours. So he take action against them, make a complaint to the Jabatan Buruh, and under the provision of the law, actually the case went to the court, and the court decided in favor of that probation person, the student. So he got actually 6 months salary in terms of being dismissed not in proper order. So dismissal, if you have problem with dismissal other than the government servant, you are talking about the private sector, you can utilize this provision of the law to take action against your employer. If you are being discharged, discharged meaning you have problems, say for example health, you can hospitalize, then obviously they want to lucutkan you punya status, they call it discharge. So also you can, if you're not happy, you can take them to court. And then if the issue of retrenchment, this is what happening nowadays, people are being retrenched just because the company is saying that they cannot make money during this COVID. So that is another area that can utilize the Industrial Relation Act. So other than that, apprenticeship. We have the Contract Act and then Children and Young Person Employment Act 1966. Yeah. Any questions so far? Yes, Asri.
So does it mean that if we earn less than 5K, we consider as an employee, and if we earn more than 5K, we consider as a workman under Industrial Relation Act?
Oh, 2000. Tapi masalah dia, when they say 2000, there are people yang workers yang kita panggil buruh ni, dia akan dapat more than 2000. Kadang-kadang kita tengok trailer, orang bawa trailer kat yang kepala hidup. Dia tahu kepala hidup?
Kepala hidup yang berpusing-pusing tu.
Yang boleh pusing kan, bila dia kan kita risau duduk dekat dengan dia kalau dia nak buat U-turn kan. So dia orang earning more than, I think dia salary is easily 7 to 8,000 per month. Tu worthwhile lah kalau jadi pemandu tu. Memang gaji dia tinggi. So are they not being able to protect themselves under the Employment Act just because they have earning of more than 2000? No, the law will come in and say that even though they are more irrespective of the amount of wages, nampak dia kata irrespective. So maksudnya di sini Allah, dia kata irrespective of the amount of wages earn a month, meaning kalau dia earn 7000, still they boleh take the Employment Act in order to be their defense. So that is why yang tadi tu bila I kata kat sini, kenapa sini 5000 pula? So 5000 ni maksudnya kalau people who are earning more than 2000 but less than 5000, they can opt to utilize the Employment Act to be their to be able to fight against the employer. Tapi dengan syarat dia cuma unpaid wages saja. okay, ataupun other payment in terms of cash. So kalaulah kata benda-benda yang apa macam medical leave ataupun benda-benda yang non apa pecuniary in nature, so that one tak boleh nak bawa. So here we are looking at those people, katalah saya gaji saya 4000, saya sepatutnya kena under protection of apa, under this one lah kan, under this one
employment
lah. Under Industrial Relation Act, sebab employee dia by definition adalah mereka yang bergaji less than 2000, mereka adalah buruh-buruh yang perlu protection lebih. So that is why Employment Act is more powerful than Industrial Relation Act. So kalau adalah sedikit yang akan keluar daripada kawasan ni, so kalau you lebih daripada 2000, you are considered as workman. However, kalau you dalam workman sekalipun, you gaji less than 5000 tetapi you tak dapat gaji, then you can utilize Employment Act untuk lawan against the employer. Because kalau Industrial Relation Act, you kena pergi ke mahkamah, you nak kena fight, yeah, industrial court. Tapi yang ni dia ada labor court. Labor court ni lagi powerful in a way lah, dia cepat. Okay, dia sistem labor court ni is officer pergi minta the HR pergi jumpa, pergi sit down and discuss the matter. Dia tak ada masa, dia bukan tak ada masa, maksudnya tak technical. Otherwise industrial court ni dia technical sikit. Okay, there are procedures that you have to go through and things like that. So boleh nampak the 5000 punya issue?
Faham sir.
Nampak good, alhamdulillah. Right, so jadi law tu tak adalah kata strict gila kan when it comes to amount of money. Yes, soalan, any questions guys? Ada? Dengar macam ada je. Atira, Rahim.
Ha. Sure, kalau maksudnya kalau yang lebih daripada 5000 tu is actually kita just use the contract act lah, itu je lah.
Tak, lebih daripada 5000 sampai kalau gaji yang tak tahu berapa banyak kan, CEO apa semua tu, they are all under Industrial Relation Act.
Oh, okay.
Dia under yang ni eh. Dia under Industrial Relation Act. Dia dalam workman, dia consider as workman. CEO pun workman, betul. Sebab dia as long as you are salary, because at the end of the month you akan dapat gaji, you are considered as workman.
Okay.
Ingat syarikat, hanya syarikat sahaja yang dia tak boleh tak terima gaji. Sebab syarikat dia is a piece of paper, as already mentioned ya. Perasan kan? Syarikat dia tak wujud pada fizikal, dia wujud pada legal, on a piece of paper. So if say for example CEO rasa tak puas hati, dia boleh saman syarikat because they are separate legal entity. CEO pun boleh saman syarikat under Industrial Relation Act. So dia boleh bawa Industrial Relation Act dengan lawyer dia pergi ke Industrial Court untuk bawa kes lawan dengan syarikat. Syarikat, walaupun dia sebagai CEO ada share dalam syarikat, but still it is considered as separate legal entity. Yang tu you akan belajar dalam SO1 dengan SO2 konsep of separate legal entity. Boleh? Siapa lagi nak tanya soalan? Good, very good. Tadi ada Atira buka. Ada tanya soalan dengan Atira, Noshikin, Noshirin, adakah? Kazana? Tak ada at this time. You can utilize the chat kalau ada, alright. So we are looking at these three act, Employment Act, Industrial Relation Act dengan Trade Union Act. So industrial, you nampak untuk officer-officer kebanyakan ya. So employment, dia untuk orang bawahan. This is more powerful than Industrial Relation Act. Okay. Sini kenapa dia more powerful? Dia banyak bagi dia punya apa orang kata? Dia punya benefit ya, yeah, untuk apa? Untuk nak jaga ya, yeah, untuk nak jaga pekerja, maka dia diberi power Employment Act ni very powerful. So ni 2012, Asset 2012. Tengok, dia kata definition dia kebanyakannya kepada establishing the relationship, wages, bila nak kena bayar, time nak kena bayar, cara nak kena bayar, you know, semua-semua dah stipulated by the law. Dan maksudnya parlimen dah tahu lah. Yeah, these are the rules that you have to follow. All employer jangan duk pandai-pandai nak buat sendiri-sendiri. Yeah, there are rules that you have to follow in terms of system of payment of wages, yeah, interest on advances forbidden. Banyak benda yeah, dia dah laid out. For example, here employment of women, provision of night work, underground work, you know. Tapi sekarang ada juga lah shift kan, tapi that is exceptional lah, they have to prove in order for them to get. So payment, maternity, apa semua, children, employment, apa semua, ini dah deleted. Domestic servant, semua, all these are, you know, semua dah provided by the law. Okay, berapa gaji, berapa rest, shift bila, holiday bila, annual leave berapa, things like that. Okay, kalau nak buat ada masalah, complain macam mana, foreign employees apa semua. So these are a very powerful act, yeah. Employment Act is a very powerful act when today acknowledged as Employment Day in order for us to celebrate, yeah, the right of the employee in relationship of working. So we are, either we like it or not, the law is there. Once we establish the relationship dengan employer saja, the law is behind us. It's just a matter of kita nak pakai dan tak nak pakai. So now the society out there should know their rights and duties. Nampak kan? Di sini ada duties kan? Duty of employer, employee, ni rights lah. Rights in terms of the boss, yeah? The employer. You, kalau you bekerja dengan employer nanti pun, you akan pakai dokumen yang sama, dengan the workers pun akan pakai yang sama. Kalau trade union pun akan refer kepada dokumen yang sama. So Industrial Relations Act, kita ada Industrial Relations Act yang tak banyak, tapi dia try to tackle in terms of things that has been done by the employer towards employee. Bukan employee, workman. So kita panggil dia pun lain, workman. So involving in terms of di sini kan, dia in terms of this particular act, dia ada mention about trade union, yeah? Mentioning about the trade union punya role, and then macam mana the trade union able to function, yeah? So here is basically you can click the link. Yeah, I think you are able to do that. Just click the link and then you have a look. Eh? Industrial Relations Act. And then the Trade Union Act. Also, this is mainly about controlling the trade union in terms of registration, in terms of recognition. Nanti kita akan belajar what are these all things. Macam mana minors. We are going to, towards the end lah, kita akan belajar the trade union. The second part, the first part kita akan concentrate on these two, okay? Especially this one, yeah? Especially the Employment Act. That is where we want to establish the relationship first. So these are the three main acts. Not to say that there are none others yang kita boleh refer to, but kita nak ambil yang main. Katalah you kerja dengan oil industry, obviously there will be some other laws that is also related to that. So Labour Court, kalau kita tengok Malaysia, they have Employment Act in terms of labour. So they are in control in terms of labour relationship. Industrial Court, link ni tak betul. Ni Industrial Court, yeah. So we have the history and then learn all this, and then just to give you this is the link that you can able to equip yourself in understanding what is their role. And then the court system, obviously, for you to make references, you want to for apa judicial review, yeah, in terms of the decision that is being made in the industrial court. So you're not happy with that, obviously you can ask for judicial review, because they try to limit issues pertaining to employment to limit only for to be settled within the apa, internal courts. Yeah, we call it the labor courts again, industrial court. Right. So that is the law. Yeah, that is the law. Now, next question. What is the difference between industrial court and labor court? Obviously, as already mentioned, industrial court is about a bigger court that handles all employee-employer relationship with regards to dismissal, transfer, and then apa, unions, you know. Those are the, as already mentioned or shown you just now, eh? So that is industrial court. Labor court, it is all about those workers, yeah, that less than 2,000 with regards to their rights. Yeah. Rights dia macam mana? Rights tentang overtime, maternity allowances, salary and so on. Okay, so those are the thing. So we can utilize this, kalau you tengok Contract Act, you kata, Contract Act tak boleh pakai ke? Contract Act boleh pakai, tetapi to establish the contractual relationship. Obviously, there was a relationship established between you and the employer when you signed the contract, right? However, there are other laws that is more demanding, more easy for you to utilize. You boleh pakai Industrial Relations Act dengan Labor Employment Act to fight against the employer. Why you have to utilize the Contract Act? However, Contract Act, when I say that, Contract Act can come in to be an evidence of the things that you agreed upon with the employer. Say for example, you dah kata saya sanggup untuk kerja ni dengan syarat saya dapat 3 bulan bonus setiap tahun. So it is stated in black and white under contractual relationship that you the employer has promised 3 months bonuses, you know, irrespective of profit and things like that. So we can utilize that. Tak ada masalah. So I'm not saying that Contract Act tak boleh pakai, boleh, tapi when it comes to employee, dia boleh pakai dua benda yang lain selain daripada Contract Act. So dia ada Contract Act, dia boleh pakai Industrial Relation Act, and then we have Employment Act. Okay, so ni ada yang that 2000 that I mentioned just now. Public sector, macam mana public sector? Ramai kita yang kerja dekat public sector kan? Agak-agak macam mana? Boleh? dah pukul 4. Kita start tadi pukul apa? 2.45. Cush. Laju ni. Okay, public sector macam mana tuan? Are they within the scope of the law that we are learning?
Maybe not.
Macam mana? Syazrin?
I think no, sir.
No, because dia public sector, dia punya authority is coming from the Federal Constitution. Okay, so Federal Constitution, dia akan bagi parlimen. Parlimen akan keluarkan law untuk non-public sector. So public sector actually is an organisation atau mandate yang dibagi oleh Federal Constitution to the government. They bypass, eh, kalau kita belajar separation of power tu. So the executive, yeah, the executive, they are administrators of the country. So they need people who are working under them. So these people, they have their own what they call it, set of law. We call it apa yang tahu? Public sector.
Dia akan bawa pergi mana, sir? Industrial court ke, labor ke, ataupun tak ada?
Dia GPA.
Dia pakai GO, kan?
Dia panggil, dia kita general orders, Perintah Am. So kalau Perintah Am is a collection of all the circulars ataupun because dia bukan di melibatkan akta yang proper. Dan dia selalu tak melibatkan mahkamah, tapi boleh juga dilibatkan mahkamah kalau keadaan boleh ditunjuk kata injustice has occurred between you and the employer. Tapi basically how to run, how the rights of people within the public sector that is being governed under the general orders. So kita ada general orders Malaysia kan? Okay, dan ada penta-pentaan perkhidmatan. So ni lah, ya. Yeah. So ni undang-undang tambahan, ini tambahannya ni dia additional lah. So you nak tengok meminjam wang, so macam mana dan dia akan bagilah sekilas-sekilas. So those people who are working with public sector macam saya, public sector lah, saya agency of government, semi kat badan berkanun kan. So kita adopt di apa orang kata, we adopt the general orders as our guideline. We don't follow tapi kita choose to adopt. Kadang-kadang kita adopt benda yang sama dengan government servant, tapi kadang-kadang kita adopt something else. So it is not a rule to be followed. But kalau you dengan under JPA, obviously everything is related to general orders. Okay, kalau public services, nah ini yang saya cakap ni for the constitution eh. So public services of estate. Okay, so di sini kan ada the general public services for the federation. So C dengan G, yeah, kalau you tengok, they are governed under the constitution. Ni article 132. So the different laws altogether. So police ada kan ada yang IGP baru ni cakap ada 129,000 police force. And kalau armed forces dia akan ada dia military akta military lah. That also judicial pun dia tak dia special skill. Okay, dia bukan macam skill kaitan kerajaan. Dia laws dia different that is applied to them. Okay, education service pun sama lah. So dia ada different dia punya class. Okay, oh ni general orders. Okay, so you can look at all this the chronological ataupun the rights and duties of people who are working in governments. Okay, government agencies, as I already mentioned, kita boleh adopt, okay, adapt and adopt. So macam nak bagi bonuses apa semua tu, kita decide sama ada kita nak bagi lebih. Then macam ITM kan, nak bagi kononnya nak bagi lebih. Ada certain agencies macam agensi berkanun yang lain yang nak bagi more, bukan 500, dia nak bagi more. Then it's up to them lah. Alright, so questions guys? Kalau tak ada, kita break for a while. My wife bising tadi 3 jam tadi kelas, you tak berhenti. Kesian kat diorang. Nak muntah dengan suara you. So 4:15 kita ataupun 4:20 kita main balik? Boleh? Atau ada soalan sebelum?
Boleh.
Boleh ya? Alright. So take a break untuk kita datang balik. Assalamualaikum. 4:20 eh?
You forgot to turn off your pin.
Assalamualaikum. Okay, saya perhatikan assignment ni kan, untuk yang 5% tu ada yang tak submit lagi kan, tak apalah. Dia sampai pukul 11.50 malam ni ya. So ada yang tak submit tu, take your time. So simple je kan. Boleh. Ada masalah kan dengan isu ni, dengan soalan tu? Ada apa-apa kan? Tentang apa? Oh, saya share tak? Oh, presenting. Okay. Ada apa-apa masalah tentang assignment tu? Guys?
Tak ada, sir.
Tak ada, eh? Alhamdulillah. Okay. Kita sambung. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. So, we are looking at the employment relationship. The keyword is relationship, eh? In order for us to utilize the law to come in. So untuk tu kita kena tengok kita kena tengok the Employment Act lah untuk nak establish, eh. Kita nak tengok ialah provision of Employment Act berkenaan dengan contract of service. So here kalau kita tengok contract of service by virtue of the Interpretation Act Section 2 Employment Act, dia kata contract of service means any agreement, whether oral or in writing, and whether express or implied. Okay, ni macam ni belajar contract law lah kan, whereby one person agrees to employ another as employee and the other agrees to serve his employer as an employee, and includes apprenticeship contract. Susah, syasyul. Right, so maksudnya di sini ialah contract of service, there is an agreement between two parties, one is the employer and the other one is the employee, right? So that is contract of service. So with this contract of service, then you can allow the Employment Act to come in to protect all parties. As I already mentioned, this is just a repetition of what I mentioned just now lah, yang 5,000 lah, yang 1,000. Okay, just to reiterate. So balik kepada IRA. We have the issue of who are the workmen, eh? So we have the case of projek kilang air batu, Nikmat and Food Manufacturing. So kebanyakan cases ni, I will try my best to be able to get a copy of the decision, or it's not a case, eh? Is the judgment, but over the time, I realized that it a worker or not. So that is the issue when it comes to workmen. So it was decided that employment and workmen is governed under the Industrial Relations Act. So what is the Industrial Relations Act view of the contract of employment, where it means the agreement, whether oral or writing, sama, whether express or implied, sama. One person agrees to employ as workman and the other agrees to employ to serve his employer as workman. Yeah. So here, the person agree is the the employer, right? And then the person that is working with the employer is workman. Different classification because of different law. So kalau you kata nak pakai IRA, then you be talking about workman. Kalau you nak pakai Employment Act, you be talking about worker or apa, employee. Right, so that is it. Now kita tengok the contract, eh. What do I have here? The Act prohibit any employment contract from accessing trade union. You cannot have what they call it, ini bagi example rasanya. Here, I just want to state here is that Federal Constitution, Article 10, freedom of speech, assembly and association give us the right to be with anyone that we want. Yeah, nobody is to force us to work with anyone. And obviously, if, say for example, you are working with that person, then if you want to associate yourself with other organization, yeah, especially when it comes to working situation, then you can choose a trade union of your choice, okay? Or maybe there are certain fixed times that is being stated by the Act, yeah, with regards to the rights of you to get whatever provision under the law, okay? The Act also compels that all employment contract as basic and minimum terms, because when it comes to contract, you know, of agreement, sometimes the employer, they try to run away from the provision of the law if they have no knowledge about the law. So they will try to give lesser than what the law is asking the employer to get. You know, kadang-kadang the number of days kerja, you know, say for example, kita ada public holidays, yeah? So they enforce people to work it on public holidays without giving them the what they call it, the rights that they are supposed to get. Yeah? Untuk kalau ni dapat dua kali gaji, or kalau overtime tiga kali gaji and things like that. So so the contract of employment, because it can vary from company to company. So kadang-kadang company yang you all working with right now, they come up with certain terms and condition, yeah, with regards to employment contract. And actually, basically, every one of you will get different terms and contract. Yeah. So tak semua sama. So, but basically, the law is trying to say that Employment Act akan bagi minimum standard. The minimum standard, or we call it flooring. Yeah. So you cannot go below the floor. Meaning the employer, kalau dia nak buat certain agreement dengan you under contract of employment, they cannot go lower than what is the one provided under Employment Act. So dalam Employment Act kata certain requirement of salary, yeah, to be given within the 7 days working after the period ends. So the employer cannot do something else that is different from the provision of the Employment Act. Meaning, dia nak bagi setengah bulan lepas bulan yang you kerja. Yeah? 15 hari selepas kerja tak boleh. Because that is the minimum standard of the law. So everyone should be getting their salary within the 7 days of the end of the period. So maksudnya, the contract can vary, however, it cannot go to the ones that is lower than the minimum standard, which is already stated by the Employment Act. Yeah, ada contoh sini. Oh, ini tak apa. Soalan? I think that is the one yang kita nak tengok, how to maintain. Tadi slide nombor apa? Allah, ah ni, alright. To determine whether an employee is a workman or employee, yeah, that is where you need to identify whether the employee is a workman or employee. Yeah, because workman, you have to determine what law, Industrial Relations Act, and then the employee Employment Act. So kalau lah kata workman nak dapat the provision that is provided, yeah, by mandatory, kalau lah kata 14 days, ya, katalah 14 days of minimum requirement. Tapi kalau employee nak letak atas lagi, which is like 20 days, 21 days per year, So it is up to the employer to do some negotiation ataupun agreement with the employee. Okay, so but they cannot go to the what kata the flooring. The kalau shilling tu tak ada shilling lah. So it's up to the contract. So different people, different contract that they sign in. Whenever you go into a relationship or contractual relationship for the same stage of work, say for example, officer, so doesn't mean that every terms in the contract is going to be the same for everyone. So kadang-kadang gaji orang lain is slightly bigger or lower than you. So because you have that, what do you call it? Expertise, you know, things like that. So different people are different, but generally they are above the minimum that is provided under Employment Act. So why this determination is important? Because only when you are a employee or employer that you are able to gain the rights that is given under protection of the law. So kita ada the case of Novacham Berhad Oi Hock Huat, yeah, where the court acknowledged the type of employment contracting catering for various form of employment. Here, engaging into independent contractor, hiring temporary staff, casual workers, and personnel of fixed terms is considered as contract for service rather than contract of service. This actually because IRA protect the security of tenure of workmen engaged under contract of service. Kadang-kadang kita tengok there are cases that goes under the IRA, the cases under the Contract Act and cases under the Employment Act. So this is the provision under Section 2 IRA about workmen, right? Sama je yang saya cakap tadi kat atas tu. Soalan for the time being? So this definition is not comprehensive but all embracing, meaning the law try to cover every aspect that is needed to protect the worker. Worker here is workman or employee lah. Okay. It does not restrict those employed under contract of employment to work for hire or reward for claiming a workman. Meaning kadang-kadang when it comes to situation whereby a person is a workman, the employer utilize that position to what they call it, bagi try to provide a provision ataupun set a provision that they are unable to gain certain access to the law. Yeah, so that is where the contract of service when it comes to workmen will be imposed. So kalau kita tengok sini, employee yang tadi itulah, yeah, employee, if you look at the first schedule, obviously it is stated that we have covered earlier. Tak ada apa-apa. Oh, ini is just apa orang kata, just explanation of the thing that we went through just now. Kan, yang kerja dekat vessel, domestic servant, you know. Okay, so I think we move to the next level is to be able to differentiate between contract of service dengan contract for service. I don't know whether you have learned this under contract law. Ada tak? Guys?
Ada
tak? Macam tak ada,
sir. Macam tak ada, okay. So in order, as I already mentioned again and again, the most important thing is to determine whether there is a contract of service dengan contract for service. Yeah. So apa yang saya kata? Oh, dokumen tak ada. Tak apa. So contract of service dengan contract for service, yeah, the word is of dengan for, right? So kalau contract for service, it is
coming from the contractor punya provision, which is contract act to be applied. Tapi kalau contract off service, dia akan ada contract act, dia akan ada employment act, kita akan ada industry relation act, kita ada trade union act. Semua ni akan masuk, ya, ada tiga-tiga yang lain selain daripada contract act tu terpakai. So it is very important for us to establish there is a contract of service. Kalau lah kata tak ada contract of service, it will be under contract for service, which is only contractual relationship. Kalau kita ambil the law of tort tak boleh masuk dalam contract for service, because whatever negligent that is being made by the contractor, you are not directly or vicariously liable. However, kalau staff you yang buat, atau just imagine that you are the employer, so if your staff is considered as your staff under contract of service, then you are going to be responsible for the negative things that has been done by your employee. Okay, so jadi kalau kita sebagai employee sekarang, apa yang kita buat, kita punya majikan bertanggungjawab terhadap kesalahan yang kita lakukan. Contohnya kesalahan tort. Okay, dengan syarat dia berlaku waktu tempat kerja ataupun dalam masa kerja. It doesn't mean that you have to be in the office itself, as long as you are doing work for the company within the working hours ataupun working place, yeah, ataupun working condition. Kadang-kadang it's not office hour, it is you pergi nak nak pergi ke branch, yeah. You ada branch dekat Johor, you are now dekat KL, in order for you to cross the states, right? So you have authority by the company allowing you to go to the branch. So it has to be only after office hours, because you nak start off pukul 6, you have to go back and then you get your apa baju-baju apa semua, and then you push off. Katalah benda ni urgent, the boss wanted you to go to that apa branch in Johor Bahru. So you travel at night. So travel at night is not within the time of the employment, bukan place of the place of the working environment. It is something that is different. However, if you met with an accident within the journey itself to Johor, to that place, that is the liability will fall under the employer. So if you were negligent, you walk laju, in langgar orang, therefore the employer can be also responsible. That you learn that dalam TOX 1 kan? Semua dah belajar TOX 1? Okay. So you know what happened, if you were to orang kata TOX, dalam TOX 2 sebenarnya.
Vicarious liability.
Very good. Okay, so vicarious liability is the one that is going to be used by people towards the employer in order for them to get compensation, because the employer is much better in giving compensation rather than the employee themselves. So it allows so many other laws to come in to protect parties that is in the relationship. So in order for us to do that, yeah, to determine whether a person, macam say for example, kita tengok Grab, adakah dia orang contract of service ataupun contract for service?
For service.
Contract, yeah? For service.
Contract for service. Contract for service. So we can see that they are contractors, but actually, kalau nak tengok dia pakai baju, you know, pakai baju dengan motor dia, dengan kotak dia, dengan everything else, nampak macam they are employees, yeah. But the liability of the company Grab is interrelated by the definition, legal definition, whether it falls under contract of service ataupun contract of service. Kalau for service, they are just contractor, and Grab would not be responsible for any negligence ataupun any act that is being done by the riders, yeah, ataupun people. So how to determine that? Okay, how to determine whether that? We have this what we call control test. Okay, a control test
being stated in the case of Short and W. Henderson Limited, where obviously you need to determine how can a person fall under a contract of service or contract for service. So the only thing is to have a test. Yeah. So macam ini, yalah, obviously kan, we don't have the law, I mean statute, to exactly state in what manner a person falls under contract of service dengan for service. So you things are being left to the courts to decide. Yeah. So the courts will come up with tests. So the first test that they came out with is the control test under this particular case, Short case. And the control test is to look at who controls these few elements, who controls the selection of the worker, who controls the payment of salary, who controls the method of work done by the employee, who has the right to terminate the work of the employee. So that it would be the question for each one of the apa element. The question is being asked. Siapa yang interview dia? Siapa yang buat decision nak ambil dia? Is it you or is it the employer or somebody else? So for example, the cleaner in your office, is the cleaner your staff or not? To determine whether the cleaner is exactly your staff, so we have to determine the control test. Yeah, so we have to apply the control test. We look at the selection. Who select the cleaner to be the cleaner? Is it your company or a company that belongs to or the employer of the, what they call it, the cleaner? Macam mana?
The employer of the cleaner.
The employer of the cleaner. Okay, that is done. For the first selection, in terms of who decide whether they want to take this particular person to become a cleaner or not, it was not done by you. Okay, you allow that particular person to come to clean your office, but actually the selection of whether she is to be the cleaner or not is not up to you, right? So cancel number one. Salary, are you the one that is paying salary towards the cleaner?
No.
Okay, so fail number two. First fail, second fail. Method of work, do you dictate the cleaning punya processes, what needs to be cleaned, how much soap to be used, what type of broom to be used?
No.
Macam mana?
No juga. Employee yang beritahu.
Employee mana?
Employee yang beritahu.
Employee dia yang beritahu kan? So what you want to do is you dictate, katalah you kata you cuti hari ni banyak sikit sebab sampah semalam kami ada makan-makan, things like that. So you dictate, nampak macam you mengarah dia, tetapi cara bekerja is not done by you. Okay, so itu pun tak ada. And then terminate work, can you terminate that person from employment? You can. Macam mana? Selalunya tak lah kan? You don't terminate the work of that person. You just call the employer, I don't like this person. I've seen him or her not doing the job, so I don't want him, I want somebody else. So you did terminate the person punya employment in your office, but you do not terminate in terms of the employment yang dia dengan dia punya employment status tu. So the control test is a good test for you to apply in order for you to determine whether that particular person is an employee or not. Kalau you fail tempat empat tu, maksudnya dia bukan your staff lah. Maksudnya dia bukan contract of service. Dia akan ada contract for service. She belongs to somebody else. Jahat saya cakap, she belongs to maksudnya macam seolah-olah macam benda pula. Ya. So dia akan ada relationship, contractual relationship of contract of service with the employer, her employer, not with us. Okay, So that is the control test. However, this control test is not definitive ataupun satu test yang bagus, because there are problem that can arise, yeah, when it comes to application of this test. I need just to elaborate the situation of the case, right? In terms of what happened, you know, right? So in this particular case, yeah, kita go through jelah. So workman contract of service, nature of employment, injury sustained in dock laborers engaging to discharging cement from the ship. Now what happened was the claim for compensation, the purchases of the cement for resale responsible for discharging M. So here actually the engaging of the staff, actually it is based on the agent of another. So dia yang sebenarnya ambil orang tu bekerja bagi pihak syarikat shipping ni. So kita selalunya kita don't engage people, but we engage agency to find workers for us. So the issue here is about who is the owner of that employee. So whether it is the shipping or not, you know. So because of the injury suffered, yeah, so the court identified that actually by virtue of the test that is being applied, it does not fulfill, and therefore that person is not considered as the employee. Now the problem, as I already mentioned about this test, is that itu nak saya cakap. Okay, this is the test being applied to Collins, you know, case. Then so this is the Collins punya case. Okay, here is about a person that is undergoing operation, patient died, you know, of injection of cocaine, yeah, that was given in by the surgeon. So the operating surgeon had ordered something else, procaine, from the telephone. It was here misheard, procaine and cocaine. So the administer that person died, you know. Now the issue is that the pharmacist dispensed the mixture without making further inquiry, meaning you have to be able to determine, excuse me, there is two similar drugs. Is it procaine or cocaine? So the act of without requiring written instruction from a qualified person, so the surgeon given the injection without checking, you know. So macam mana you rasa benda ni kalau lah kata berlaku dekat adik-beradik you? Kalau berlaku dekat adik-beradik you, when it is actually a normal operation, but it turns out something else. You obviously wanted to sue the hospital, betul tak? So you wanted to sue the hospital. Sometimes when it comes to hospital, they engage people for what they call it, for practices, yeah. So the practices is regarding to what they call it here, contract of service exists when employer have the power to instruct and control the methods of work. The problem with doctors is that do employers have the right to instruct methods of work? Because dalam tadi kita kata methods of work is the one that is being done by the employer. If the employer can be shown that they know how they can control, then it fit in into this test. Betul tak? Selection mungkin ada, salary mungkin ada, but method of work, kalau doctors, they are not able to control the method of work of the the doctors. So kalaulah selection ada, wujud, tick, salary, tick, you know, termination tick, tapi method of work tak ada. So tadi I kata selection, the control test will be effective kalau ada 1, 2, 3, 4. 1 campur 2 campur 3 campur 4. Tapi kalau dah number 3 tak ada, because you cannot control the doctor of how he operates, dekat mana dia nak kena operate, macam mana dia nak operate, macam apa yang nak kena buat dulu, apa yang nak buat kemudian, because this is considered as an art, something that is only doctors knows how to do their operation. Say for example, sama dengan lecturer. So you assign a lecturer to be teaching, but it's up to the lecturer to apply the method of teaching, right? So macam mana? So this method of work is slightly different from one person to another. You know, different doctors having different practices, different approach. So the question is, the control test is not a good test to be applied when you cannot meet the method of work, because method of work for doctors are slightly different from one another. So macam mana you nak kata the doctor is actually under contract of employment when the method of work cannot be controlled? So this is actually the problem with control test, where when it comes to method of work, it is ineffective. It is unable for us to really identify whether that person is able to be controlled by the employer. Contoh kita ambil lagi satu, pilot. Contoh kita ambil crane workers, yeah, crane workers yang dekat bangunan tinggi-tinggi, yeah. So how do you engage to control the method of work by that person? So you might be the person that is paying the salary, selection, terminate work, but method, now employer would like to be able to run away from responsibility, kan? This particular test is to be used to determine whether that person is an employee or not. So obviously, because of the inability for the employer to control the method, they will say it falls under contract of service. Contract for service rather than contract of service. So this is going to be a problem for you. Say, for example, if you want to sue the hospital say, excuse me, we are the one that select that person. We pay him the salary. So, you know, but we also can terminate his work. But the method of work done by that person is nothing got to do with us. You know, macam mana? What is your opinion on that? Bawa kereta terbang, okay, ada selection, ada salary, ada terminate work, tapi method of work macam mana nak bawa, ketinggian apa nak kena bawa. So this is something of a nature problematic, kan? I don't know about you guys, you rasa macam mana?
Rasa ikut dia, rasa maknanya orang kita dah gajikan dia, tak kisahlah dia nak buat macam mana, janji kerja tu jalan.
Ha, kalau kerja tu jalan, maksudnya dia bukan, dia bekerja dengan method dia sendiri, you tak control method dia. So kalau dia, you tak control method dia, dia bukan adalah staff you. Pada definition control test, selagi you tak ada empat-empat ni, maksudnya kalau you fail salah satu, which is this method, then dia akan terus jatuh lucut jadi contract for service. So kalaulah kata orang yang mati itu adalah adik beradik you, untuk saman hospital, you tak boleh ada vicarious liability punya linkage. So you nak saman bukan nak time, nak you nak saman 2 juta ataupun 5 juta. You nak saman doktor berapa banyak sangat gaji yang dia ada. Kalau neurosurgeon mungkinlah banyak sikit, 100,000 sebulan. Tapi kalau normal GP ataupun specialist, dia mungkin gaji 20,000. But the thing is, you want that 5 million now. So mungkin ada, you kata ada insurance, tapi insurance of the doctor dengan insurance of hospital is something else. Dia coverage dia tinggi. So you want that hospital to be responsible. In order for you to make the hospital responsible, you kata ini staff you, you kena responsible. Dia kata ni bukan staff saya. Kenapa you kata bukan staff saya? Method of work control is not done by me. dia yang pilih mana nak buat. Saya suruh dia buat operation ni je, tapi cara menjalankan tugas itu tu pulang kat dia. Dia yang silap buat operation tu. So dia bukan staff saya. Ah sudah. Dah macam mana? Right? So this is the dilemma that is going to be faced by by applying this control test. So what I'm trying to say here is that the control test is not actually a good test for us to settle when it comes to problematic title ataupun ways, example captain of the ship, doctors, you know. So jadi macam mana kita nak buat? So they came up, they meaning the courts, they came up with what we call organizational test, this organizational test ni is the test that we apply to ask the second layer. Tadi the first layer kita check dulu control test, and then the second layer kita tengok at the organizational test. Apa maksud organization test ialah kita tengok whether that particular person, he is doing something that is integral part of the organization. What do you mean by integral part? Whether that particular doctor is the integral part of the hospital. Is his practice that he's doing, is it integral? Adakah dia sebagai satu paksi ataupun benda yang utama kepada the activity of that institution ataupun organisation? Doktor dengan hospital memang ada sinonim kat situ. Kalaulah kata kita letak nurse, nurse pun kita tak boleh kontrol, kan? So adakah nurse tu integral part? Kita nak determine sama ada orang tu adalah staff ke tidak. Maksudnya adakah dia contract of service atau tak? Apa yang you rasa?
Part of the hospital saja.
Nah, adakah dia integral? Nurse?
Yes.
Okay, so jawapan dia ya. Orang lain macam mana? Integral ke tak? Lukman, Asri, tadi siapa cakap? Syayuti ke? No Shirin? Mana yang lain? Suara budak-budak.
Integral.
Okay, integral. Maksudnya integral adalah you kena determine. Kalau untuk saya, kita ambil lagi satu contoh. Saya dengan UiTM. Saya sebagai pensyarah. Pensyarah, adakah pensyarah ini integral ataupun satu benda yang orang kata dia punya berpaksi kepada orang kata functions university. University adalah function dia apa dia? Mengajar, kan? So tenaga pengajar pensyarah adalah integral to the functioning of the university. Maksudnya nampak tak dia punya relationship? Adakah staff-staff ITM yang lain integral? Kalau tak ada dia, maka tak boleh function. Boleh tak universiti jalan kalau lecturer tak ada? Tapi staff tak ada. Tak boleh,
tak
kan?
Boleh.
So di situ
boleh,
di
sir.
Ha? Boleh.
Tak boleh. Boleh.
Tak boleh lah. Sebab katalah staff office yang kita pergi dekat office, kan? They can function, tapi they are not integral. Because kalau dia orang tak ada sekalipun, dia orang kita eliminate, the teaching punya activity can still continue. Sebab lecturer ada. Kalau hospital, nurses tak ada, still the doctor can function as a doctor without the assistance of the nurses. Yes, nurses is important, tapi not to the extent that they become the one that is, you tak boleh nak kata kalau dia orang tak ada, tak boleh function. Kalau lah doktor tak ada, boleh tak you nak rawat patient dengan nurse saja?
Tak boleh.
Tak boleh. So this is another new test that is being established. Kalau lah kata captain of the ship, kata captain of the ship ataupun kapal terbang, boleh tak kalau captain kapal terbang tak ada? Boleh tak pramugari itu bawa kapal terbang? Tak boleh, kan? They can only assist in terms of
sama dengan captain of the ship. Yeah. So boleh, dia orang boleh bawa, tapi they are not apa orang kata, they are not assigned to really know how to maintain from point A to point B. Mungkinlah for 10 minutes dia boleh pegang tu, tapi the fact that nak bawa kapal terbang tu sampai daripada atas nak turun bawah, itu memang tak boleh. Yeah? Doesn't make sense. So they came out with organizational test as a test to be able to determine whether that particular person in question, whether that person is the integral part. If that person is the integral part of the organization, then he is the contract of service. Contract of service, eh? Okay, which is this one, yeah? So, bila ada contract of service, masuklah semua law yang kita duk discuss ni, yang mana yang kita duk tengok. Okay, boleh nampak tak guys? Nampak dah tak larat. Dia orang ada dua kelas tadi. Kesian kat dia orang. Dah letih sangat ni.
Nampak saya.
Nampak saya. Cuba untuk nampak.
Okay, corporate, dalam corporate kita ada banyak position.
Yes, betul.
And none of the position tu irreplaceable.
Aha, okay, good. So jadi kita pakai macam ni.
So itu contract actually, yalah, itu contract of service lah kan, sir?
Sebab pasal apa, kita kena tanya dulu sebelum kita kata bagi jawapan. Saya bagi dah jawapan kan. Sepatutnya kita apply the integral part. Tak boleh nampak pun siapa yang integral part. Every one of them are integral to the function of the organization kan, ataupun company. So macam mana ni? So dia akan apply to the test yang awal lah, which is the control test. So kalau control test pun, I think control test for the time being, dia akan dia akan jadi control test plus, ya, yeah? Control test plus the organizational test, which is actually a combination of both. Okay. Contoh ni Mak Yusuf ni. So we have a combination of the test. Banyak. Kita ambil multiple test, ya. Yeah? So kita ambil multiple test is a combination of both in order for us to identify. So the court has to have some kind of guidance, because decision dia nak buat untuk semana-mana case is to be applied to all courts. Betul tak? Kan? So nah, itu you belajar MLS kan? So standard that has to be maintained by all courts. So dia mesti pakai test yang sama untuk semua courts. So so isu yang you kata tadi tu, when it comes to company yang di mana ramai pekerja tak tahu siapa siapa, that is method of work tu, kita walaupun nampak macam ada isu sikit, right, tetapi they go along the line that orang kata you term, kan kita terma syarat kita terima pekerjaan, dia akan bagi apa, scope of duty. So dalam scope of duty tu dah dinyatakan you akan letak dekat mana, you akan buat apa, you know, that is covered under that method of work lah. Boleh jawapan saya?
Boleh sir, tapi kan
saya boleh rasa you tak puas hati.
Okay, sebab memang corporate, the integral part tu kita susah nak determine lah for me. Sebab yeah, kita ada board of directors, kita ada management team, CEO and so on.
Betul.
So kalau salah seorang tak ada pun, kita ada lagi orang lain untuk jalankan business of the company. Okay, pasal yang method of work tu, so in case kalau in the middle of the contract, sebab depends lah, kalau orang yang top management ni selalunya dia ada contract for service, but yang lower level ni contract of service. Kalau ada tukar-tukar the job scope ataupun reporting line, itu akan reflect tak dalam contract? Supposed to be reflected ataupun employer ada hak untuk tukar je?
Yeah, selalunya the last term dalam contract of service tu, they akan bagi from time to time, any instruction that is going to be given to you from time to time. So kalau contract of employment, dia akan masukkan clause tu. Clause tu yang akan jadi actually the most powerful clause. Dia akan bagi more or less you akan duduk dalam HR, you akan buat sekian-sekian, you know, things like that. Dia detail out lah. Dan lain-lain pekerjaan ataupun lain-lain task that is given by the management from time to time. So actually itu pintu keluar untuk syarikat menggunakan that clause to run away and give you instruction to do certain other things. Normally kalau contract for service, you can always argue in saying that contract for service, you can always argue with the company, actually you contract me to do A, so if you want me to do B, then you have another contract. So that is normally done lah, contract for service. Tapi kalau contract of service, they can run away from that responsibility by invoking that clause. Selalunya. I don't know whether I answered you or not. Rasa macam I tak answer dia. Did I answer you?
Okay, kot saya boleh lah.
Tak. Dalam syarikat itu, tadi you tanya, Syarin, you tanya about the situation yang happens in your company kan, di mana syarikat dia macam mana? You cerita sikit balik.
Okay, okay. Company normally for top level management macam CEO ataupun lagi level lah, vice chairman or board of directors. Dia punya terms dengan company normally contract for service. Dia ada term service from when to when, and then dia punya job scope dia apa macam mana lah. But lower level ni dia adalah contract of service. But sometimes company bila dia venture into something, dia akan change the terms of the work. So dia boleh simply tukar ke, ataupun kalau employer lah contract of service, dia boleh simply tukar without the consent of the employee, sebab kita dah sign kan the employment letter and so on. Sebab itu kind of contract between company dan kita lah as employer.
Boleh?
So
jawapan dia boleh lah.
Boleh tukar.
Boleh, tapi dia kena justify lah. Kalau benda tu daripada HR kepada macam saya kerja dekat kilang dulu. Saya kerja dekat HR, tapi bos saya kata something is happening dekat manufacturing. So saya saya ditransfer daripada HR ke manufacturing. Which I told my GM, dia kata, I have no idea of the area, this is not my forte kan. Manufacturing, planning and manufacturing. Bukan setakat manufacturing, ya, planning. Jadi kita nak supply kepada Proton, anything goes wrong, 1 minute of downtime dekat Proton is 5,000 penalty tau. Satu minit downtime dekat production line di Proton, dia akan penalize kami. One minute is 5,000. Kalau 10 minit, dah 50,000. So I stated my worries, but he said that I need you to be there to investigate and see what is happening. Memang betul lah, bila I masuk, I nampak lah benda yang berlakunya. The first day, orang luar yang purchasing ni, I handle purchasing, planning and manufacturing. Gila punya kerja. I kata macam my life is ending lah. Kau nak kerja 3 department altogether. The first day orang datang berjumpa, how much do you want? Contractor luar, okay, the seller, the one that is supplying our materials, dia datang berapa, how much do you want? I said, dalam office, you know, I mean, if you have someone that is able to come to you and ask how much you want, means that something hanky-panky is going on. Sampai dia tak ada nak jumpa, tak ada malu, alah, you know, tak jumpa kat luar, or telefon, any direct front in front of you dalam office you. I was like, wow, okay. So that is in relation to what you are asking, memang boleh lah. If you can always say that I don't want, you know, but they cannot force you, right? They cannot force you. But you selalu akan blacklisted lah.
Tapi kan that kind of arrangement dia kena formalize ataupun
Oh yes. Dia kena. Sebab kalau dia tak buat macam tu, dia akan open up to action. Yeah, if you report. Because kalau anything happens to you, katalah I duduk kat processing kan, I buat blunder. You know, when katalah I buat blunder and then something happen. Now they want to sue me, right? Or someone else yang because of my thing that I have done, right? Yang suffer, sekarang they want to sue me. Sebab bila dia nak sue, dia tak boleh nak sue because tak ada black and white. Because I am holding a position that is based on instruction saja. So what is my job scope? Tak ada. It was not stated. Then I am responsible for the mistake that I have done when I under that particular department. That doesn't make sense, again, yeah? Because the thing is for you to have change of consequence. Kalau change of consequence, that maksudnya you pegang dua post. Kalau you pegang post pertama is kerja hakiki. Lepas tu you secondment because orang tu resign, you telah dilantik untuk pegang post tu sementara orang lain masuk. So there must be a black and white. Otherwise, anything happen when you do that particular second job tu, you're not going to be responsible. You boleh angkat tangan. You know, yeah, I'm not going to be responsible because there was no proper appointment.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So, I tanya Cik Mas kejap eh. I tanya Cik Mas buku apa. Ha, Cik Mas kata, boleh. Ni Cik Mas kata ni tak sampai 5:45 ke dia orang ni dah nak pengsan. Tak ada siapa nak jawab saya dah. Kesian saya. Kesian you all lah. So, kalau nak tengok yang ni, good eh. So, test apply kat Malaysia. Jadi, test yang dibuat dekat mana-mana negara, kita akan tengok the functionality ataupun the goodness of the test bila kita apply dekat Malaysia. Okay? Anything that is being made elsewhere, dekat overseas ke, mana-mana negara ke, they are not binding towards us unless and until kita apply. So here, the test is being applied in the case of Mat Yusof bin Daud dengan syarikat Jaya Seberang Takir. Now, he was working in a sawmill punya factory and then carrying logs, and then he was discontinued employment because they injured. Eh? So he sued for damages, and the defense of he is actually a worker of another, the contractor of another employee. So here what happened is that the defendant denied liability, contending that the plaintiff, meaning Mat Yusof, was not the employee, but the employee of the defendant contractor Lim, yang apa jadi orang agent. So it went to the court, and the court held that Lim was not to be held as a contractor as he was not undertaking to execute any part of the defendant sawmill business. Nampak tak? Business is sawmill. Mat Yusof ni dia buat apa? Dia angkat kayu kan? So kalau angkat kayu is the integral part of the company. So here, he was merely as a middleman saja. Lim ni, dia cuma middleman saja. So nampak tak syarikat ni try to run away, syarikat Jaya Seberang Takir ni, running from their responsibility to be responsible to Mat Yusof and saying that, excuse me, we don't actually responsible to you because you are just a contractor for service. Yeah, jahatnya syarikat eh. So the macam mana nak calculate pula? So nak tengok pula number of logs. Okay, so number of log kita boleh identify that bila nak kena angkat, berapa number of logs yang nak kena buat, dekat mana logs tu nak kena letak, you know. Those can be identified in terms of that the activity of that person is the integral part of the company. Okay. So they kata wages and number of logs on determined by the defendant, meaning the syarikat Jaya tu, would be the integral part of the organization. Therefore, he is a employee. Okay. So yeah, it is a good test to be applied whenever there is a issue when it comes to method of lagi satu case. I think lagi 5 minit kot boleh eh? Kita tengok I think better lah kesian kat you all. Now for you to go back and read this ready mix and Minister of Pension National Insurance case. Ada I bagi facts sikit kat sini. There are cases yang kalau you nak tengok online, kalau ready mix ni you just click lah. Ada case Wikipedia pun ada, you know. Ni bukan dia. Ni ready mix tu lah. The case ni ada case. Okay. Banyak ready mix Wikipedia pun ada. Okay, it's a big case that you can understand, and looking at the case itself, kita akan tengok macam mana. Okay. Right, can you do that, guys? I don't want to impose on you the
macam cancer.
InsyaAllah can, sir.
Boleh, eh?
InsyaAllah, you... sir.
So, thank you so much. I mean, thank
you. So, can we have the slide, yeah?
Oh, obviously, I have already given. Tapi kalau you nak lagi, tak ada salah. Tidak, eh? I will pass it over soon after this. Recording sekalipun.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Dah letih.
Dah letih sangat.
Sorry. My apologies.
Tak apa, sir.
It's okay. Okay, now. Semangat. Untuk nak buka puasa pula. So, assalamualaikum. Thank you so much for coming and lending your ears, yeah.
Selamat Hari Raya, sir.
Oh, Nazida. Kejap. Umi Asma, dia kena salam kat you. Dia Umi, you buat asasi dengan madam eh?
Ya. Okay.
Lepas
saya pernah jumpa madam dekat Perlis. Masa tu madam pi makan harum manis.
Kita makan harum manis dekat bab punya dusun tu. Ya. Yeah. Ingat? Tak ingat. Oh, you jumpa dekat sana?
Ya, saya jumpa.
Ada dekat tepi jalan
ke? Ya, makan
tepi jalan. Ya. Dekat Perlis. Kita jumpa dia. Umi Asma Salabi. Tengoklah saya ni memang Salsabila. sorry. Madam tu kalau dia tengok muka dia lagi ingat lah. Tapi saya ingat dia jumpa you.
Saya sekali batch dengan Anur.
Anur? Oh, sekali batch dengan Anur
sahaja? Ya.
Oh. Anur kat mana sekarang?
Saya tak pastilah, sir.
Saya berjaya. Kami dah jumpa juga. Dia still in contact with saya lah.
Ya, saya sama batch dengan dia, Nani. Madam ingat kot.
Kahwin dia dah pergi?
Tak, saya tak pergi pun, sir.
Dia COVID kan? Kan. So, okay. Thank you. Thank you, Muhammad Amin. Thank you, Umi. Thank you, Atira. Thank you, Muhammad Habizi. Ada dah soalan ke nak tanya? Ada soalan? Tak ada. Ada ke? Not yet. Okay. Assalamualaikum. I have to remove you in order for the... record to end. Thank you. Assalamualaikum.